So shall I revise it tomorrow or shall I do it today or some other time?
Or
Tomorrow.
time one something.
Hello?
Ma'am, we can do it on Friday. Like after all the classes get over at 3.
Your voice is
What
not
about time
audible.
after the classes?
After the on Friday, you're telling. I cannot hear your voice. Jayant, I'm sorry, I'm not able to listen. Anyone else want to speak? Jayant, your voice is not audible.
Or 2:30.
Hello?
Ma'am, I'm telling.
Jayant is telling that on Friday you can keep it after 3:30. After all the classes, basically.
Okay, after 3:30 on. Yeah, hello, hello. After 3:30 on Friday, what does I have basically? Friday, I have third hour class for.
But this Friday is 1st May. So it will already be a holiday.
Okay. Oh, Friday will be an holiday, is it?
Yes, ma'am. May Day.
May Day, right. It will be an holiday. Okay, fine. So shall we do it from 2:30 to 3:30 on Friday?
Yes, ma'am.
Is it fine? 2:30 to 3:30,
ma'am.
Or you want at 3:30?
2:30 to 3:30 is fine.
2:30 to 3:30.
Okay, so Friday we will revise from 2:30 to 3:30. Okay.
Ma'am, and can we have that class on Google Meet?
That class on Google Meet. Okay, I will. Yes, we will just try one class in Google Meet. Not a problem to it.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Fine. So I'll just brush out with some concepts related to the fifth module since we have still time. Okay, so basically the fifth module deals with applied mechanical measurements. So how do we measure the force measurement, the torque measurements, the pressure measurements, the power, and different type of dynamometers. So all these things are dealt in our fifth module. Okay, so I just wanted to show you the, I hope you people have the syllabus with you all, right? Or else I will just share you. Just a second, I'll share the syllabus. So we have for your test, you'll be having introduction to metrology, linear measurement and angular measurements. And second module, which we dealt with limits, fits, tolerance, and gauge designs, comparators as well. So that will be the portion for your test. So later we covered up the module 3 related to screw and gear tooth measurements. And then we dealt with measurement systems and basic concepts of measurement methods with respect to transducers. Again, modifying and terminating devices. So this we have completed. So the fifth module deals with applied mechanical measurements. So in this, which are the applied mechanical measurements we are going to measure? These are the measurements of force, torque, pressure, then the type of dynamometers comes into picture. I'm sorry, it got disconnected. Okay, so again, we used So this was completed module 4. In module 5, we deal with the measurement of force, torque, pressure and types of dynamometers and the use of elastic members. We study how an Bridgman gauge works and its other type of gauges. And we have measurement of strain and temperatures. So where you will be studying the thermocouples, the pyrometer, optical pyrometer, how does it work? How does an electrical strain gauge works? What is the preparation and mounting of the strain gauges, normalities, formalities which is being used, how to determine a gauge factor. So all the things associated with the strain and temperature measurements, you will be studying in a different part. So these two covers our module 5. So basically we have to start up with the applied mechanical measurements only related to the room temperature. So where you will not be focusing on the temperature or any strain effects, just the measurement of the force, torque and pressure, what type of instruments we have for measurement and types of the classifications. So this is the outer view of our syllabus. So now let us share with the PPT related to our fifth module. So this is the module what we are starting related to applied mechanical measurements. So I discussed you with the syllabus already. So now you should know what you mean by force. Force you have studied right from your 9th, 10th, in your plus 11th and 12th also. So how do you define a force? As per our Newton's law, force is nothing but mass into acceleration, which is measured in the unit in terms of Newtons. So whenever you apply a force on an object, so it will help in getting a direction for the movement or for a rotation. And it could also increase the acceleration rate as well, right? So basically the object accelerates due to pulling or pushing them with the application of a force. So this is the direct measurement of force and general concept how a force is being defined. But now we have to focus on measuring the force also. So in order to measure the force, basically there are two methods. One is the direct method and other one is the indirect method. So what happens in direct method? This involves a direct comparison with a known gravitational force on a standard mass. Example, a physical balance. Right, so it compares with a standard. You will add standard in one plate and you will keep the quantity what you have to measure in another plate. Then you will verify by the movement of the spring. So whether it is balanced, whether it is showing deviation towards the unknown quantity or showing deviation towards the standard. By that you will vary and check. So this is one of the example for the direct method. So measurement of acceleration of a body of a known mass which is subjected to the force. It is also one of the examples. So when you apply a force on an object, the body could be moved or it could be accelerated. So the amount of acceleration indulged in the body due to the applied force, you can measure it directly. So what is the indirect method of measurement? So this involves measurement of the effect of the force on a body. So when you apply a force, some result you are getting. So that you will measure directly. But when you apply a force on a body, some changes happens within the body. So the body could deform, your body could resist, or it could be a rigid body, it could be a viscous body, it could be an elastic body which deforms easily, or it could be a semi-rigid body. So where some changes comes into picture. So what is the effect of the application of force on the body will be studied in indirect method. So these are the two ways of measuring the force. One is the direct and the other one is the indirect method. So this is the actual picture of what you mean by a force and how it is being measured. So after this, we have some classification and different methods which are being followed. So when a force has been applied or what is the effect? So if a load is being applied, what happens in the body, within the body, and how do you measure? For everything, you should be having a measurement method. So it can be classified into 2 to 3 categories. So one is the scale and balance. So it comes under analytical method basically, which are measured with the help of scales and balances only. So under that we have different classifications. These are equal arm beam balance scale, unequal arm beam balance scale, multi-lever platform scale, and pendulum scale. So everything here are measured with the help of using an scale, balance scale basically, and hence it comes under the category of scales and balance. So with the help of scales and balance you are measuring. And next is based on the elastic force meter. So if you use some external elastic force for measuring, then which type of measuring instrument you have? It is only the spring scale method. Apart from that, you have a different unit, what we call it as a load cell. So when you apply the load, what is the measurement, how you are measuring, what are the quantities you are measuring? So that you will be analyzing by 4 different methods. One is a strain gauge load cell, hydraulic load cell, pneumatic, and the linear variable diffusion transducer, LV transmitter. So this is LVDT. So these are the different type of measuring methods which are available. I'll just focus with only one method for today. Equal arm beam balance scale. So rest could be taken care in the next class. So what do you mean by equal arm balance? Everyone have seen, you will be having 2 equal arm at the center. You will be having a pointer which shows the reading in the scale. So one you will measure the standard mass, and in the other you will keep the unknown mass. So if there is no deviation, if both the weights are same, then the pointer will not show any reading at all. Remember, the scale what you will be using will be a calibrated one. So if you have the variation in the unknown mass, if the unknown mass is more than that of the known mass, then also this will come down, this will be moving up. So you will be having some deviation, the pointer shows some deviation. If the unknown mass is less and the standard mass what you are using is more, so then this comes down, this moves up. So again you will be having some deviation shown in the calibrated scale. So you'll come to know which is more, which is less, then you vary accordingly so that both you will get in accurate comparison and mapping of standard mass with that of the unknown mass. So this is also called as an analytical balance method. You are not using any numerical type of calculations. It is just basically on analytical based one. And hence it is called as an equal arm balance, since it uses equal arms on both the side to compare with standard to unknown. So what happens here? So direct comparison of an unknown force with the gravitational force can be explained by using the analytical balance. So whenever you have weight what you have added, so there will be a force acting downwards due to the gravitational force. So even that comes into the picture. So the direction of force is parallel to that of the direction to that of the gravitational force, and hence only its magnitude need to be determined. Okay, so the constructional detail of the analytical balance is as shown in the figure that I have explained you already. So what does it include? The balance arm rotates about the point O. So you will be having a balance arm and it will be located at the point O. So this, the balance arm which rotates about the point O. So this will be the point O. I can show you one more image. Yeah, the half section of it. So this is the point O on which the balance arm rotates. Okay. And the two forces W1 and W2 are applied at the end of the arm. So you will be having the two forces which has been acting due to the weight applied towards the gravitational force. So this will be the W1 and W2. what will be acting. So W1 is an unknown force and W2 will be the known force due to the standard mass. So you always keep the unknown force at W1 and known force at W2. So this will be the mass of the standard mass, this will be the mass of the unknown. So point G is the center of gravity, the CG of the balance arm. So you will be having the balance arm. So this is the point G in which the center of gravity will act. So this is done. And everything goes on if W1 is equal to W2. But if the balance is unbalanced, but if the balance is not done, and if it is in unbalanced position, when the force W1 and W2 are unequal, this unbalance is indicated by the angle theta. So any variation in the weight of the known and the unknown mass, then that will be shown in the calibrated scale. So that deviation will be determined as theta. Hello? Hello? And hence that balance position will be shown by the reading theta. So therefore the weight of the balance arm and the pointer do not influence the measurement. So the balance arm what you are using, okay, and the pointer what you are using will not influence the measurement. It directly depends upon the weight of the standard and the weight of the input, weight of the unknown mass. So based on the difference, you will get the variation in the angle theta. So this is sensed by the sensitivity of the balance. So sensitivity of the balance will be given directly by the change in the angle with respect to change in the weight. When you compare from standard to that of an unknown mass, what you have to determine. So how sensitive the given balance is, that will be identified with respect to the variation in degree what you are getting and what is the difference with respect to the standard and the unknown mass. So that will define you the sensitivity of the balance. Okay, so this is the point in which the arm rotates. So this in which the CG of the arm takes place, the center of the gravity, and this will be the pointer which shows the reading, and this balance arm will be located with the two pans to measure the known and the unknown mass. So due to that, the weight will be suspended at the three points, one at the center of the gravity, one at the point one here where you will be having the standard mass, and W2 you will be placing the unknown mass, unknown weight of the mass what you have to calculate. So you will be having W2 acting, W1 acting in a particular inclination. Why? Because there is a deviation in the scale. If it is exactly to zero, then you will not be having deviations. So when you have the deviations, then the WB will not be exactly perpendicular to the gravitational pull. It will be inclined to a particular angle. Then you have to resolve that into the cos component and the sine component to determine the values. Okay, so the length, so this from the center through which the arm rotates, so from the center to the location of W1 will be called as the arm length L, and here also it will be the same. So if you apply the momentum equation at equilibrium, so everyone know how do you apply a moment equation at equilibrium, your basic mathematics. So you will resolve the weights here into cos component and sine, cos component and sine, cos component and sine. Then you take the equilibrium condition. So here the standard mass will be equal to the unknown mass plus the weight which is acting across our CG, right? So that you are now resolving W1. So this is W1. So this is W2. So this is WB, right? So you will write now W1 cos theta, W1 sin theta. Similarly, WB cos theta and sin theta. W2 cos theta and sin theta. Then you equilibrate under the equilibrium condition. So at that time, you get W1 of L cos theta minus dB of sine theta. So that should be equal to W2 of L cos theta plus dB sine theta plus WB dG sine theta. So this will be based on the distances which is given from dB, dG and L. So what are these dB, dG and L? Did I tell you? So O I told you, which is the balance point and point at which the arm rotates. So W1 and W2 are the applied weights at the two arms. So W1 will be known and W2 is the W1 is unknown and W2 is the standard mass. So G is the center of gravity. So WB is the weight of the balance arm and the pointer G at acting. So weight of the balance arm and the point at which the G is acting will be our DG. Okay, so same thing. L have told you what you mean by it. So now for small deflections, the angle sine theta will, if you, after you derive, after you get this equation, you will consider or assume sine theta is equal to theta and cos theta is equal to 1. Then you replace accordingly. Then the equation becomes W1 L, because you are assuming cos theta is equal to 1. So it is just L minus dB and you are assuming sine theta to be equal to theta. So you will retain only theta here. So that will be equal to W2 L times cos theta is 1 plus dB times sine theta is just theta plus WB into DG you will write and theta remains the same. So now we are reducing the equation. So where the distance DB, DG and L are shown in the figure. So these distances are already shown in the figure. So this is the center with which the balance arm rotates. This is the center of gravity. The distance from the center as per the arm rotates due to the deviation. So this is the variation you are getting in the distance from the center to that of the gravity. So this is the variation you are getting in the distance from the center O to that of the weight of the measuring arm. You will be having the weight of the unknown. So measuring arm is referred to be as B here. Just a second. No, that B is not mentioned over here. Usually we call it as measurement arm B, or else we can consider leave it. So we will just explain you the concept. So this is a standard mass. So this is the unknown mass what you have to measure. So when this is more, this will come down. So weight of the standard will move up. So the distance here will be different and distance here will be different, because it can rotate either towards your clockwise or it can rotate up and in anti-clockwise direction also. So this distance keep on varying with respect to the variation in the weight of the standard and the unknown. So these are the distances what we get as a gap with respect to the variation in the balance arm and with respect to the variation in the center of the gravity what we get due to the rotation of the arm from the center point O. So this we have done already. So okay, so that was the thing I wanted to tell. And later, this is for the large, small deflection angles. And for small deflection angles, sometimes it could be also assumed sine theta is equal to theta and cos theta is equal to 1. And the above equation becomes in this way. So this we have written already. So then the sensitivity could be replaced. So sensitivity we defined already, that is equal to the variation in the angle to that of the variation in the weight what we are measuring with respect to standard and to the unknown. So when you assume the values of sine theta to be theta, cos theta is equal to 1, and when you simplify these equations, you can replace that in this way. So all the sine and cos terms goes away. So only the dB and dG elements retains with respect to our W1 and W2. So W1 is the known mass, W2 is the unknown mass, and these two club together with the difference what we are getting with the moment this one weight arm. And plus, again, you will be having the weight of the unknown mass with respect to the variation what we are getting of the moving arm from zero to that of the gravity. Only this part will be retained. All other cos and sine terms will be omitted. So you have two different equations for smaller deflections when you assume in a different way. So here you can see sine theta is equal to theta and cos theta is equal to 1. So when these values are submitted numerically, you will be retained only with W2, DB and WG. This theta value goes away. So only you retain these terminologies from the existing equation. So at the equilibrium, everyone knows the known mass will be equal to the unknown mass. So we can consider W1 and W2 to be equal to be W. So in that case, again, the equation changes. It is L upon 2 times W. So this both will be same. So you will be having 2W in place of W1 and W2. And you will multiply that with respect to dB. Plus again, this will be the same. So the sensitivity of the balance will be independent of the weight provided. It is always assumed that dB will be equal to 0. So the variation of the distance dB at equilibrium will be always 0. Why? Because both will be same. dB and dG will be same at the equilibrium because in the scale will be showing 0 reading. Only when you have the variation in the scale due to variation in the weight, the dG and dB gets varied. But in the equilibrium, since both will be the same, the dB value remains same. There will be no value and hence we will retain only the dG term. dB will be assumed to be zero. So sensitivity of the balance mainly depends upon the weight provided. It is not based on the value of dB. So this is about our equal arm balance. So if they ask you to explain the equal arm balance and how you calculate the sensitivity aspect of it, you have to explain what you mean by it. You have to draw the sketch. You have to show how sensitivity is evaluated. And if needed, you can show the weights, how you resolve and apply the moment equation at equilibrium. And how do you correlate this moment equation at equilibrium to the sensitivity? And so finally, it mainly depends upon the weight which is being provided to measure. So the given weight could be either equal to that of the standard mass, or you might be having a lesser weight than that of the standard, or you might be having a more weight than that of the standard which has been given to measure. So based on the weight provided, the sensitivity factor will get varied. So this is how you have to understand and explain related to equal arm balance. So remaining thing I will be doing in the next class. So if anyone have not written the name in the chat room, kindly do add it up. If any doubts, you can ask. On Friday, we do take one revision class as suggested at 2:30.
Another 2:31, since I will be free on that day, can it be done in the morning itself?
Fine, no problem. Morning, is it okay at 8:30, 9:30?
So 9 will be fine. Nine.
Is it fine with everyone?
Yes,
please. Yes, sir.
Okay, so we'll fix it up at 9 o'clock in the morning. Done?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, fine. So we'll just brush out the first and the second module. Okay.
Okay,
yes. Fine. Then, yeah. Everyone take care. Have a nice day. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, bye-bye.